In the early hours of April the 28th, 1908, in a farmhouse in the town of LaPorte, Indiana, farmhand Joe Maxson awoke to the smell of smoke, which he first thought was the smell of breakfast, and then, as he regained consciousness, he leapt out of bed in a panic. And as a cloud of black smoke bellowed up from below his windowsill, his fears were confirmed. The house was on fire. He ran down the servant stairs and dived outside, into the yard. Realising the landlady and her children were still sleeping, he circled the house, flailing and yelling, and banging on the doors. But soon, flames lapped at every window. Neighbours arrived on the scene, and began smashing windows and trying to break down the door, hoping to see some signs of life. But there was nothing, only the crackle of the flames. And soon followed the sound of wood and bricks crashing as the building began to collapse. By the time the firemen arrived, it was too late. The house had burned to the ground. In the smouldering ruins of the basement, the bodies of three children and an adult female were discovered. But the strange thing was, the body of the woman was missing its head. Although they had not always seen eye to eye, the neighbours mourned for Belle Gunness. The woman seemed to have nothing but bad luck. She was twice a widow, had lost multiple children, and she had spent years looking for love, and her life was fated to end in this horrific fire. Just days after the incident, Ray Lamphere, a former farmhand whom Belle had recently been having problems with, was arrested, suspected of arson and murder. The ensuing investigation would put LaPorte, Indiana on the map, and the name Belle Gunness would become infamous. Who was Belle Gunness? Belle was born Brynhild Paulsdatter Storset in Norway on November the 22nd, 1859, to parents Paul Pedersen Storset, a stonemason, and Berit Oldstatter Storset. She was the youngest of eight children, and the family lived in a small cottage farm in central Norway. They were very poor and relied on raising farm animals and growing just enough crops to survive. There's very little reliable information about Belle's early life, but there were plenty of rumours. One story is that Belle had become pregnant by the son of a wealthy landowner. He had no intention of marrying her or providing for the child, and one day, Belle attended a country dance, and as she was leaving, the man attacked her and beat her severely and caused a miscarriage. The event changed her personality, and some people believe that it may have left her unable to have children. The man was never prosecuted, but he died a few months later of a stomach illness. The symptoms were like those of arsenic poisoning. There's no documentation to verify this story though, and it's most likely folklore, but it's a great setup for the story of Belle Gunness. So, I'm gonna go with it. In 1881, following an invitation from her sister Nellie Larson, Brynhild moved to the United States, settling in Chicago. Like many other immigrants opting for an American-sounding name, at 24 years old, she became Bella Peterson. She took low-paid domestic work, with which she paid the Larsons for her upkeep. Bella, however, had no intention of spending her life slumming it with the hoi polloi. She had much bigger plans. In 1884, Bella met and married Mads Sorensen, a fellow Norwegian who worked as a store detective. Bella volunteered for a Lutheran church. Through her church activities, Bella was able to collect money to relocate unwanted children and carry out illegal abortions. It's not known whether Mads was aware of everything that was going on, or if he did, perhaps he just didn't want to believe it. Bella longed to have a child of her own, but she was unable to conceive during the early years of her marriage. So, when the wife of a family friend became gravely ill, she jumped at the chance to foster their young daughter, Jenny Olsen. 1894 was the year that Chicago serial killer H.H. Holmes was caught. Famed for his horrific murder castle, his modus operandi was murder for money, and he was known to have made multiple insurance scams. Is it possible that he was an inspiration for Belle? The couple opened a confectionery store, but the business wasn't very successful, and the shop mysteriously burned to the ground within a year. They were able to collect the insurance money, with which they were able to move into a three-story home on the fringe of a well-to-do suburb. Between 1896 and 1898, the couple became the parents of four more children, Caroline, Myrtle, Axel, and Lucy. It's debated whether or not these were Bella's own children. It is possible that she took in the unwanted infants in exchange for money. Caroline died at 5 months, and Axel at 3 months. They were thought to have died of acute colitis, the symptoms of which are similar to those caused by poisoning. The lives of both children were insured, and the insurance money was paid out. On the 30th of July 1900, a doctor was called to the Sorensen's home. Mads was laying on his bed, fully clothed and dead. According to Belle, he had complained of a headache, so she gave him some quinine for the pain, and when she checked on him later, she had found him dead. The death was not reported to be suspicious. However, the coroner was a friend and previous tenant of the Sorensens, and there was no toxicology report. Mads Sorensen had two life insurance policies, one of which was due to expire at the time of his death. Bella had applied for the insurance money the day after her husband's funeral, prompting Sorensen's relatives to claim that Gunness must have poisoned her husband in order to collect the insurance. An inquest was ordered, but the cost of exhumation was so expensive and the case was basically dropped, and Bella was able to collect both policies, totaling $5,000. She used the money to buy a 40-acre farm on McClung Road on the outskirts of LaPorte, Indiana. It was at that time that she changed her name again, from Bella to Belle, which is apparently more American sounding. While preparing to move to the farm, Belle became reacquainted with a previous tenant, Norwegian-born Peter Gunness, a widower, father of two girls, and a butcher by trade. Described as a fine-looking blonde Viking of a man with clear blue eyes, a pointed beard and mustache. The two were married on April the 1st, 1902. Only a week later, while alone in the house with Belle, Peter's infant daughter died of edema of the lungs. Just 8 months later, on Tuesday, December the 16th, Peter had a tragic accident resulting in a fatal head injury. According to Belle, Peter had been scalded by a pan of hot broth that was knocked from the stove, which caused a cast iron sausage grinding machine to fall from its shelf, hitting Peter in the head and splitting open his skull. She claimed to have found him on the floor, alive but with burn injuries. She said she treated his burns and told him to rest, and then upon finding him dead, she told her daughter to get help. However, a local physician conducted a post-mortem and found no evidence of scalds or burns. What he did find, though, was that Peter's nose was lacerated and broken, showing evidence of severe blows. Most significantly was an inch-long laceration through the scalp and external layer of the skull. It was concluded that the death was due to shock and pressure caused by fracture and intracranial hemorrhage. 5-year-old Myrtle Sorensen was overheard telling a classmate, "My mama killed my papa. She hit him with a meat cleaver and he died. Don't tell a soul." While some dismissed it as nonsense from the mind of a child, suspicions grew and rumours spread. There was talk of possible foul play, and the port's residents began to question Belle's explanation. And the issue of the death of Peter's infant daughter was raised. Belle made sure to put on an emotional display at Peter's funeral. An inquest followed, and Belle was interrogated, but there was a lack of evidence, and Belle got away with it. Peter had a $2,500 life insurance policy. His brother, Gust, wanted to ensure that his surviving daughter, Swanhild, would be the recipient. Belle fed him some lies about how the policy had been turned over to a mining company for the purchase of stock, saying that Swanhild would receive it if it was ever worth anything. But there was no documentation to back up her claims. During his brief visit, Belle tried to persuade Gus to stay and run the Gunness farm, but he declined, and the next morning she awoke to find that he had returned to Wisconsin, taking Swanhild with him. This turned out to be a good move. Swanhild was the only child to have survived living with Belle. She went on to have her own family and lived till the age of 65. A few months after Peter was laid to rest, Belle allegedly gave birth to a baby boy. When the midwife arrived, the child had been born, bathed and dressed, and Belle was going about her day as if nothing had happened, and the child didn't look like a newborn. Belle had been on good terms with the residents of McClung Road, but issues involving livestock had caused her to butt heads with one of her neighbours. Belle complained that the cows had trespassed on her land. In fact, she had found them grazing along the road and driven them onto her land, and then demanded payment for their return. When the neighbour attempted to retrieve his cattle, Belle pulled out a gun and threatened him to pay up. And when some of Belle's pigs did the same thing, he responded equally. Following this, they never spoke or set foot on each other's property again. With Peter gone, Belle worked the farm herself, doing everything from planting crops, milking cows, pitching hay, and butchering animals. But by winter, she needed help, and preferably somebody she could take as a lover. So she posted classified ads in Norwegian language newspapers. Although able to converse in English, Norwegian was the only language in which she could write. In February 1904, 30-year-old immigrant Olaf Lindbo arrived at the farm with his worldly belongings and $600, which was his life savings. He was immediately hired, and the two became lovers. Within 2 months, Olaf wrote his father in Norway with word that the couple might soon be wed. But a few days later, his life would be ended. When neighbours inquired, Belle gave contradictory statements for his sudden departure. It took 4 years for anyone to discover the pieces that remained of him buried in the pig pen. In April 1905, Henry Gerholt came to work on the Gunness farm, bringing with him a heavy trunk. And in August 1905, Belle told her neighbour that Gerholt had suddenly quit. Late that summer, a new classified ad appeared in a Norwegian language newspaper, and the following winter, Mrs. Gunness was seen wearing Gerholt's fur coat. Belle's postman later reported that he delivered, on average, 1 to 4 letters every morning, and sometimes as many as 8 or 10. Among the first to respond this time was George Berry, another Norwegian immigrant who left his home in Illinois, telling friends he was moving to LaPorte for a job and possibly marriage. He took with him $1,500 in cash. A few weeks later, Christian Hilgven of Dover, Wisconsin, sold his farm for $2,000 and headed to LaPorte. Emil Tell, a Swedish bachelor from Kansas, quit his job and travelled to LaPorte with $2,000 in his pocket. 50-year-old widower Ole Budsberg from Wisconsin sold his farm to his sons, telling them that he was going to LaPorte to get married, and arrived with $1,000 in cash. In December 1905, a 40-year-old bachelor, Joe Moe from Minnesota, cashed in $1,000 in checks before travelling to LaPorte. In 1906, during a time when Belle had nobody staying at the farm, she hired a man to dig some pits in the hog pen. They were to be 6 foot by 3 foot wide and 4 foot deep. Belle said they were going to be rubbish pits. In the summer of 1906, a 49-year-old Norwegian, Andrew Helgelian, began what would be an 18-month correspondence with Belle Gunness. Around that same time, Belle's foster daughter, 16-year-old Jenny Olsen, was reported to have gone away to college in California. She left suddenly, without saying goodbye to friends and admirers, and in spite of Belle's promises to Jenny's admirers that she would tell her to write, she would never be seen alive ever again. One of Jenny's admirers was a young farmhand by the name of Emil Greening. The two had grown very close. He continued to work on the farm, believing he was sure to hear from Miss Olsen, But having heard nothing by June 1907, he decided to quit his job and leave, which was a good move because he lived. He was soon replaced by 37-year-old Ray Lamphere, the son of a once prominent politician and schoolteacher. Ray was a skilled carpenter, but was reputed to be a gambling alcoholic, described by one journalist as a shiftless loafer and a bum. Bit harsh. Belle and Ray became lovers, which Ray would boast about when drunk. But he was never going to be enough for Belle, but she kept him around and made use of him on the farm. He was willing to perform almost any task, no matter how grim. Many would speculate about the reasons why Belle, a coarse-looking woman of around 200 pounds, had become irresistible to scrawny Ray Lamphere, although it wasn't unlike many men before him. The couple became a regular sight, often riding into town in Belle's wagon and then side by side strolling around the town. Belle had continued to write to Andrew Helgellian, unbeknownst to Lamphere. And then in January 1908, after several months of persuasive correspondence, Andrew Helgellian showed up, and within a few hours of one day, the appearance of this burly stranger would pull the rug from underneath Ray's feet. He was to turn over his room to Belle's new guest and move into the barn. Helgellian and Gunness were seen together in the First National Bank, attempting to cash in some checks. They were told to return a few days later, and the cashier counted out $2,839, half in gold coins and then the remainders in currency. That same day, Belle sent Ray on a mission to deal with a horse trade in Michigan City, about 12 miles away from the port. He was supposed to spend the night there, but later that night, he told his friend that he would be heading back to La Porte. As it turned out, there was no horse to trade. In spite of Belle insisting that Andrew not tell anyone about his plans, he had informed his brother Asley. He said he would probably be back in a week, but it had been almost two. So Asley decided to ask around and then decided to look in his cabin to see if he could find out where Andrew might be. And there he found a large pile of letters, which were signed Bella Gunness. Throughout January 1908, Belle had been having problems with Ray. Having previously been her lover, he had become jealous of Belle's suitors, in spite of the farm having what was basically a pay now, exit never policy, but I guess maybe he didn't notice all the burial sites. And he began making scenes, which prompted her to fire him. Shortly after, she went to the local courthouse and declared that her former employee was not of sound mind. She convinced local authorities to hold a sanity hearing, but he was pronounced sane and released. She was back a few days later, complaining to the sheriff that Lamphere had been on her property again and that he posed a threat to her family, and he was arrested for trespassing. So anyway, back to Asley Helgellian, who had found this pile of letters, the contents of which had prompted him to contact Belle and ask a few questions, which is definitely not what you want when your property is full of bodies, and she definitely didn't want him turning up on the doorstep. She responded, telling him that Andrew had been there, but had left. She wasn't sure of his whereabouts, but he mentioned something about travelling to Norway. The response did not satisfy Asley at all, and he had a feeling that something was very wrong, so he decided to make some inquiries about his missing brother and contacted the sheriff in La Porte. The interesting thing about Andrew Helgellian is that he was an ex-convict, no stranger to a scam, and he'd seen a thing or two, but somehow, unlike so many before, he had fallen under her spell and gone into her home with the promise of work, good food, and the love of an experienced older woman. Of course, who would have suspected this homely farmer's widow, a Christian woman and a mother to young children? Who could have guessed that in this home that smelt of delicious home cooking, Bella had owned her skills in poison and butchery? While Asley continued to make inquiries, Belle was still dealing with Ray Lamphere. She visited her lawyer and told him that she feared for her life and for the lives of her children, and that Lamphere had threatened to kill her and burn down her house, and she wanted to make a will in case he went through with it. And so her lawyer drew up a will, in which her estate was left to her children. This time, Belle didn't report Lamphere's threat to the police. Most likely because there were no threats, and she was in fact setting the stage for what she was about to do. She was seen withdrawing a large sum of money from the bank, and that same day she purchased kerosene. And this is where we go back to April the 28th, 1908, when Joe Maxson, who had been hired to replace Lamphere, escaped a house fire, and all that is left is a gutted heap of smoking ruins, and in the basement lie the remains of three children and a headless woman. Ray had been arrested for the fire, and the residents of LaPorte had grown concerned over the issue of the headless body. Many suspected that the body was not Belle Gunness. The remains were measured, making allowances for the missing neck and head, and it was stated that the corpse was that of a woman who stood 5'3" tall, weighing no more than 150 pounds. Upon hearing this, friends and neighbours of Belle insisted that there was no way that this could be her, because Belle was a big-ass woman. Local tailors who made clothing for Gunness were able to confirm her measurements from their records. She was taller than 5'8" and weighed around 200 pounds or more. Like I said, she was a big-ass woman. Taking into account the effects of the fire on the body, the authorities concluded that the headless woman could not possibly have been Belle Gunness. A pathologist in Chicago revealed that the organs of the headless body contained lethal doses of strychnine. Strychnine is a type of poison, but in the past, very small amounts were used in pill form to treat various ailments. However, it is extremely toxic, and today it's mainly used in pest control to kill rats. It's also found mixed with street drugs such as LSD, but only in very tiny amounts. Now convinced that his brother had never left LaPorte, Asley Helgellian travelled to the Gunness farm. The investigation had extended from the charred remains of the house to the surrounding land and the hog pens. On May the 5th, 1908, 4 feet below ground, a box containing the dismembered, disfigured, and badly decomposed remains of Andrew Helgellian was uncovered. The several trash holes that Belle had had her farmhand dig, it was revealed, were in fact burial sites. That same day, another horrifying discovery was made. The remains of Belle's foster daughter, Jenny Olson. She hadn't gone to study in California. It's possible that Belle killed her, believing she knew too much about the death of Belle's second husband, Peter Gunness. As more remains were unearthed, the public descended on the LaPorte property, and the case attracted media attention from all over the world. People were selling postcards, even food vendors had set up. It was like the circus had come to town. Whole families would take picnics and travel to spend the day visiting the now famous Gunness murder farm. That day, a total of 5 bodies were retrieved, and following that, many more remains that could not be identified. The search for any further victims was finally called off. The investigation revealed the gruesome methods in which Gunness had murdered and disposed of her victims. After luring them in, she would poison them and then finish them off with blunt trauma, which was evident in the skulls that were found. Using her butchering skills, which she had learned from her husband Peter, Belle would decapitate the head, remove the arms at the shoulders, and sever the legs at the knees. Burlap sacks were found containing torsos and hands, arms hacked from the shoulders down, masses of human bone wrapped in loose flesh. The bones had been crushed on the ends, as though they had been struck with hammers after they were dismembered. And finally, quicklime would be scattered over the faces and stuffed in the ears. Sometimes she would place the bodies in the hog scalding vat, or chop them up and feed them to the hogs. Because if there's one thing that hogs are useful for, it's getting rid of bodies whenever you are in a hurry. Because sometimes there's just not enough time for these things. Not that I would know about these things. The investigation focus was now on the identification of the headless woman. There were some people that insisted it really was Belle. A dentist came forward saying that if they were able to at least retrieve a dental bridge that he had made for Belle, that would surely confirm that the corpse was in fact Belle. So a miner was hired to sift through the wreckage using a sleuth. Whether the missing dental bridge was considered solid proof of Belle's death also depended on where you landed politically, because the case took place during a presidential election year. The Republicans were saying that Belle was dead, and the Democrats were saying that she had escaped and was still alive. If Belle had arranged it and gotten away, that meant that Ray Lamphere was most likely innocent. But the Republicans believed that they had the right man. Sure enough, on May the 19th, 1908, a piece of dental bridge work was found and was identified by the dentist as work that he had done for Gunness. As a result, the coroner concluded that the body was in fact Belle Gunness, and she was declared officially dead. During the trial of Ray Lamphere, his lawyer presented evidence to contradict the dentist's identification of the recovered bridge work. He argued that if the gold plating on several pieces of gold jewellery had melted completely away in the fire, then the gold bridge work would have also been destroyed. And in spite of a supporting testimony from a local jeweller and an experiment involving a similar piece of bridge work and a blacksmith forge, and with a testimony from Joe Maxson and another witness who said they had seen the sheriff with the bridge work shortly before it was discovered. However, on November the 26th, 1908, that's my birthday by the way, write it down, on November the 26th, 1908, the jury found Ray Lamphere guilty of arson. He was acquitted of the murder charges. Lamphere died only a year into his prison sentence of tuberculosis. It's reported that shortly before his death, Lamphere stated that he hadn't killed anyone, but he had helped bury some of her victims. Whether this is true is debated. He also cleared up the question of the headless corpse, allegedly. According to Ray, days before making her escape, Gunness had lured a woman from Chicago under the pretense of hiring her as a housekeeper. She drugged the woman, bashed her in the head, decapitated her, tied weights to the head and threw it deep into a swamp and placed the body in the cellar. Joe Maxson testified that the night before the fire, they had arrived home around 5:30 p.m. An hour later, he and the Gunness family sat down to a beef steak supper, followed by cookies and jam. And when the meal was done, the five of them, Maxson, Belle, Lucy, Myrtle and Philip, went into the parlour and played games. By 8:30, Maxson was feeling tired, so he excused himself to bed. He said goodnight, and that was the last he saw of Mrs. Gunness. She was sat playing with her children. A short while later, she would have chloroformed all three children and smothered them to death, placing their bodies alongside the headless corpse that lay in the basement. Then, as fire ravaged the property, Belle had fled with the money that she had withdrawn the previous day. Most of the remains found on the Gunness property could not be identified, and the exact number of bodies is unknown. Reports suggest at least 12 to 14 bodies, but there were many more names of missing people that were possibly linked to Belle Gunness, and some people believe she may have had as many as 40 victims. Jenny Olsen's admirer, Emil Tell, went on to marry and have his own children, but he said he never forgot young Jenny Olsen. Following the disappearance of Belle Gunness, there were multiple sightings of the murderess, reported from all over the United States. Unsurprisingly, since the case was on the cover of every national newspaper, but a nationwide manhunt cost money, and the sheriff already had a body with her name on it, which meant he could wrap up the case. But there was one name in particular that many people are still convinced was Belle, a woman by the name of Esther Carlson. Mrs. Carlson had been arrested for murder and was linked to a number of crimes with a similar playbook to Belle Gunness. Mrs. Carlson died in Los Angeles at the age of 72. There was never any solid evidence that it was really Belle. Recent DNA tests were performed to try to find out if the children found in the fire were in fact related to Belle. Unfortunately, the results were inconclusive. So what do I believe? I believe that she did get away, and I'm not so sure about this Carlson woman, but I suppose it's possible. But whatever the truth is, the story of Belle Gunness is legendary. Her name pops up in all sorts of places to this day. She appears in 12 editions of the Guinness Book of World Records under the category of Most Prolific Murderess, which is kind of horrible. And there is even a stout named after her. And there was a band called the Belle Gunnesses, and she has her own section in the town of La Porte's Historical Society Museum. So that's the end of the story of Belle Gunness. I'm not sure what you can take from that. Maybe when someone's offering to make true your wildest dreams as long as you can bring along all your cash, just say no. And also, we learned that pigs and a lot of land, in certain situations, are very useful. But perhaps don't turn your home into a mass grave. I'm planning to do some more of these serial sims focusing on historical crimes. So let me know what you thought in the comments below. Subscribe to the channel and hit the bell to be notified when a new video lands. And now, go ahead and poison and dismember and bury the like button. Kill Sims.